The next 2 days are really about celebrating entrepreneurship. In a couple of minutes, 10 very young entrepreneurs partly will join the stage and we will celebrate their success stories. Many of the entrepreneurs are part of a new generation of young people that are very excited to solve local problems in their local communities. We really believe that it is this young generation that is the driver of a new Africa and a new African capitalism. With new business models, they are addressing problems in their communities, addressing issues in water, sanitation, healthcare. We will see some of the business models in a short while. So during the last few months, we have been working with a lot of these enterprises, not only getting to know their business models, but also getting to know the challenges that they are facing on their journey to turn their ideas into viable businesses. Driven by a lot of conversations with these young entrepreneurs, we thought we wanted to get a better and more systematic understanding on the challenges that they are facing, and this led us to the report that we are launching in a couple of minutes. This report is really dedicated to the youth of Africa and making their voice heard, the challenges that they are facing, but also showing some of their success stories that they have been showing on their way. So we are confident that this next generation can be the driver of an inclusive growth in Africa if we provide them with a right ecosystem that combines risk-taking capital, but also trust, because the youth often faces the challenge of being trusted by the more adult and mature generation. We want to provide them with more affordable but also accessible services and accessible networks, because youth often faces the challenge of being excluded to not actually access a lot of the business networks. So it really requires a collective effort to create this ecosystem, and this is why we would like to start a conversation with a lot of the people that are in the room today. How can we create an ecosystem for young entrepreneurs in Africa? So we have the pleasure to now have with us Honorable Johnson Sakia, who is the chairman of the National Alliance, who will provide us with his perspective on the role of youth entrepreneurs in a new Africa. May I ask you on stage, please?
That was close. Following what just happened at the AU, and our new chairman, for those who've been following social media, the new president of the AU had a similar experience, so it means I'm going far as well. That is Uncle Bob. Thank you very much for inviting me for this function. I'd like to start by thanking IntelCap and SunCap. I need to get out to pronounce those names, for giving me the honor of being part of the panel and just coming to share part of my experience in building young entrepreneurs in Kenya. I think for the benefit of most of our international guests, I'll introduce myself, and I'm not assuming that everyone from Kenya knows me, but my name is Sakaja Johnson. I am a member of parliament. I am the chairman, the national chairman of the National Alliance, which is the ruling party in Kenya. For the Kenyans, wapi kidole? I know what I mean. I'm also chairman of the Kenya Young Parliamentarians Association, which is an association of young members of parliament, both at the Senate and at the National Assembly, who are young. According to the strict definition of young, that is between ages of 18 and 35. And it always shocks the audiences whenever I speak, when I tell them that in Kenya, in my association, I have 48 members who are below the age of 35 in parliament. That is a first. So I want to really thank both SunCap and IntelCap for convening and having such a discussion at such a important time in our history as a country, in our history as a continent, at a time when a new generation of Africans are seeking to don the historic mantles of taking leadership and being included and being part of the economy of the continent. Indeed, Africa is a young continent, as I've heard being said here. And as young as it is, Kenya is the third youngest country in terms of the median age. I believe our median age is around 18, 20 as a country. At a time when most of the challenges that are facing us as a continent and the challenges that are facing us as a country are really the challenges that are facing our young people. I think it's very important for us to have this discussion around this time. I have been involved in setting up a lot of what I'd call the software behind the thinking when it comes to youth engagement in our country with this government, being part of the team that did the manifesto. I remember when we launched the political party TNA, I was saying that what we want is not those with millions of shillings in their accounts, but those with millions of ideas in their minds. But based on this discussion, I think I was wrong. We need both. Those with millions of shillings in their accounts and those with millions of ideas in their in their minds. And we must provide such linkages. We have taken a leadership role in ensuring that the young person in Kenya, the young people, are involved in, or rather included, in the economic life of this country. Despite Kenya being very young, actually only 3% of Kenyans are above the age of 60. I would shock you. Only 9% of Kenyans are above the age of 50. A great majority are those between the age of 35 and below. But what is disturbing and shocking is that it is only that 9% that are the majority of those holding capital. So you have a huge majority of young people who do not have employment, do not have access to to jobs, and that of course government cannot provide jobs, because we need to provide an environment where jobs are created. And you have a small percentage, either in the private sector or even in the public sector, who want to hold on to their capital. So we felt that we must have certain initiatives which can make sure we mainstream our young people into the economic life of our country. One of the first things that we did, which was part of the Manifesto Dream, and part of what I have brought forward in Parliament as legislative intervention, is that for the first time in Kenya, and I think in, I don't know if there's any other country that has this, if you have this in your country, you can lift up your hand. We have put a specific quota that in every financial year, 30% of all procurement, value of procurement, must go to the young people. I don't know if that happens anywhere else. That is a point to clap for us. And what this means is that, and I'm very proud and fortunate that, I mean, I'm glad that that was the first private member bill that passed in the 11th Parliament, which I sponsored, that in a financial year where the national government in Kenya is spending, say, 1.8 trillion shillings, 30% of that, if you remove recurrent expenditure, salaries, and take 30% of 1 trillion, is 330 billion Kenya shillings. That we've created an enterprise of young people who can take part in 330 billion shillings a year. That is the biggest company in East and Central Africa. There's no company that has that kind of turnover, be it Safaricom, be it BAT, be it EBL. And the challenge now is how we as policymakers, we as government, work with the private sector to make sure that our young people not only take advantage of the opportunity that we've created by creating that quota of 30% in business at both national and county level, but also how we're able to grow sustainable business enterprises for our young people. We do realize that cheap money does not work. You don't solve the problem of our young people by just throwing money at them, and that is not what we are doing. But we want to give opportunities for as many young people as they exist in our country to get, an opportunity to do business, an opportunity to hire others. We don't assume that every young person is a businessman. And that is an assumption that many policymakers make, that if you cannot get a job, you can definitely run a business. There are certain people who are not accustomed to or don't have the qualities of being entrepreneurs. So we have a number of programs that we've actually spearheaded to make sure that we get business training and to make sure that we create synergies between national government, we as lawmakers in parliament, and the private sector. Another opportunity exists in the youth service that we have, the National Youth Service, where we're getting young people from every part of our country, enrolling them into a youth service that is moving from the traditional physical work and spades and building bridges, but into business training. I think that an ecosystem that we need to create in our country needs to have all those components around it. We need to be able to get you in the private sector to create mentorship opportunities for these young people in different parts of our country. We need to be able to have the right infrastructure, and of course there is work for government to do, the right business infrastructure and environment, the right regulatory framework, and of course there are certain laws that we are pushing to do that, including a redoing of the Companies Act and the Business Registration Act, the procurement laws in this country. That is ongoing. Of course, we definitely need to look at education and training, because you cannot have one without the other. We need to have quality education, where our young people, no matter where you know they're learning from, whichever part of the country or the continent they're coming from, should be able to have at an elementary stage the right skills to impact the communities, to fill the gaps that exist in the communities, because I think that then is an entrepreneur's mind, to fill in those opportunities. We also need to make sure that we have the correct type of funding, or you know, affordable capital, affordable funding for these young people. Recently, I remember I was at a restaurant in Nairobi, and a young person came to me and told me, you know, Mheshimiwa, that's what we say here, honorable, I must give you this money. And of course, I was taken aback, because in my line of work, you rarely offered money, you mostly give it. And this young person was very eager to give me 100,000 shillings, and I said, please, I can't take that, what is it for? And he told me that because of the legislation and the laws that you sponsored, I've been able to, for the first time, engage in business. I am supplying salt to the military, you know, of all things, salt to the military, and I've made so much money that I want to give it to you. And the first time that I got a local purchase order, I went to the youth fund, because we have an institution called the Youth Fund in Kenya, that even as we give our young people the capital, we are financing the local purchase orders, and the young people are getting opportunities to do real business. Now, many young people across this country, and those of you who are, you know, conversant with that will agree with me, have shied away from taking advantage of these opportunities, because they just say it never works. You cannot work with government. And when you ask them, have you ever applied for a contract? Have you applied for any tender? And they say, no, you'd never get it. So we need partners to spread the word. We need development partners. We need the private sector. Government should not, I mean, government is not trying to do business, but we must play that facilitative role. And government policy dictates the direction we go to with respect to creating the right ecosystem for young entrepreneurs. I think we are moving in the right direction. Only recently we've had Fortune 500 saying that forget about the BRICS, that now there's the Lucky Seven that are coming up hot on the trail of Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, and Kenya is the only country in Africa that has been mentioned as part of the Lucky Seven. So in as much as sometimes we may, you know, not be very optimistic about the business environment in Kenya, the space for investors, I'd like to tell you that Fortune has noticed it. A lot of the world is noticing it. And for you investors who are here, I would like to urge you to invest in the young people of this country. Kenya is an economy that is growing, that is about to take off on the throes of greatness. And it is not because of oil revenue. It is not because of our minerals. It is not because of what is under the ground. And believe you me, there is a lot. It is because of what is above the ground. It's because of our people. And the young entrepreneurs in Kenya are resilient. The young entrepreneurs in Kenya are hardworking. They have ideas, they're innovative. And thus, I urge you to really take them seriously and to create this link. I would personally, and on behalf of the young parliamentarians, as I finish, you know, today I have two challenges, to talk about a report I have not read and to talk for 10 minutes as a politician. But as I finish, I would like... I would like to give my commitment personally, and also the commitment of the young parliamentarians, to be able to close the loop between private sector, between capital, owners of capital, and government policy. I think unless we listen to each other, unless we agree that we must confront the challenges that young entrepreneurs have, the challenges that private business have together, then we will not be able to succeed in any way. So we'd like to engage you, we'd like to sit together in forums. Strathmore Business School is doing a brilliant job, and I must thank them for that. SANCAP and INTELCAP, we are willing to sit down to discuss this at whatever level,
to see how best we can help each other create that environment and that ecosystem to help young entrepreneurs. So with those very many remarks, I'd like to thank you for listening to me and thank you for participating in this very important conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Johnson. Thank you. Please stay on stage, please. Stay on stage, please. May I ask Anurag to give a small token of appreciation to Johnson? Now I would like to call on stage a young entrepreneur who is himself running an incubator in West Africa to share a perspective on the youth ecosystem in West Africa. So may I ask on stage William Senior to please share your perspective.
Ecosystem builders, it's always a refreshing thing to see that governments understand what needs to happen. So thank you for that. We need more of you on the continent. As you notice, a lot of what is happening here is East African-Indian connection, so they had to throw in a skinny West African too. But my job here is very simple. To share some quick insights from the perspective of an ecosystem builder working with young entrepreneurs, which is one of the toughest things you could commit your life to at this point. But we've committed ourselves to it, a bunch of very energetic young men in Accra trying to build something. And so from the perspective of the West African ecosystem as compared to East Africa, I've always known that there are a lot of white spaces within our ecosystem. But God, I mean, East Africa is on fire. What I've seen over the past couple of days, I mean, I've always suspected it, but you guys are eating our lunch all day. But there's a lot that we can do. West Africa has a lot of energy, and like East Africa is very youthful. So there's a lot of some cross-cutting things that we can leverage. But the key points here is, I want to share three key learnings as an ecosystem builder working with young people. That, in my view, it's three things that need to change in the West African ecosystem. I see a lot of it here in East Africa, but they are probably far along compared to us. So, support systems. We are all drinking the Kool-Aid of, you know, Africa rising, young people doing amazing things. But what we see now is a saturation in the base. Everyone's trying to organize hackathons, events, networking, business plan competitions. And then it ends. It stagnates at that point. No one is trying to actually build a continuum of support that takes some of these ideas to market, profitability, and scale. Because that's what we need right now. Some really rock stars in the space, making millions and building back as angels of some sort. That is not happening. And I know we might be impatient in a lot of ways, but there's a lot to learn from other markets. Israel, Silicon Valley, all of that. So we don't need to make the same mistakes. We think that continuum of specialized support systems should be built to be able to make sure that a lot more people are progressing from some of these competitions and actually executing. And trust me, I know when I say from my own failings that that is one of the biggest challenges in the West African ecosystem. So the next point is talent. There's a lot of smart young men on the continent. I won't dispute that. But what we need in the ecosystem to make sure that it thrives and grows really quickly is more of mid-career people who are quitting their 9-to-5 to build startups, coming with core skills and capabilities to actually execute on ideas. The whole, you know, there's this bushfire effect of everyone coming out of college and starting a business. It won't work that way. What we need is people with operational competencies actually executing on great ideas. And that must change how we incentivize some of these mid-career people to join the ecosystem is a whole new conversation on its own. But I think that needs to happen given our own experience in working with younger people. So there has to be a good mix of young entrepreneurs, fresh, you know, greenhorns, excited, but also really strong mid-career professionals with core competencies, mixing up and creating that great teams to build good startups. And the last bit, and we learned this lesson, the hard way. Money makes it all move. You can have all the energy, you can have all, you know, the altruistic mode, but in the end, you have to be able to capitalize. We were naive enough to think that our energy and some small capital can take us across the certain thresholds, but that didn't happen until, you know, we got some US government support and all of that. So if there's anyone here very energetic, trying to build a hub or innovation space, my advice, don't build on the shoestring. It won't work. You end up being very mediocre and no one wins. So the ecosystem must have support, and as an earlier speaker said, philanthropic capital and patient capital must help support such grassroots innovation system. Now, for us as a West African bloc, one of the two things excite us in terms of ecosystem building, the emergence of, or the coming into town of Impact Hub with serious institutional capacity from building hubs across 60 plus countries. We think their presence in Africa will most likely cause some serious technology shifts and most likely also change some of the dynamics within our own ecosystem. And then the launch of the Tony Oluwelu Fund TEP program, which is trying to reach thousands of young entrepreneurs but with specific assistance that goes through the entire continuum, as I propose. And then finally, I'll be ready to stand on this platform and not use this as an opportunity to create some concrete actions. So it's all well and good to have an East Africa ecosystem report, but what about West Africa? We have to understand what needs to happen within that space, and some of you, the stakeholders in this room, are the brightest people to talk to launch something like that, that looks at the landscape and sees what we can all do together to fill some of those white spaces. So, and to conclude, I'd like to point out to Vinny of IntelliCap yesterday when he was justifying why they are not in Africa yet, West Africa yet, he said they were advised that if you go to West Africa, there are two possibilities. You either leave a billionaire or you leave with no shirt on your back. I want to promise you that when you come to Ghana and you base in Accra, chances are you leave a billionaire. There are hundreds of Indian millionaires to prove that in my city. So take that into consideration. So I'm calling on as many stakeholders here who are interested in trying to see what is happening in the West African space in a more holistic way to join us, launch a report of sorts to see what we can all do together, maybe probably with IntelliCap at some point. Thank you.
Thank you, William.